So today we will discuss an overview of the upper and lower GI endoscopy. This is just a theory in which we will discuss some of the historical aspects, some of the important points. The definition is, endoscopy is a minimally invasive diagnostic medical procedure that is used to see inside the abdominal cavity with the natural orifices. You will not make any opening like laparoscopy. You have to enter into the abdomen, interior surface of the abdomen, to see the pathology by the natural orifices of the body. History is very interesting. It was first invented in 1806 by Philip Bogini. At that time, there was only fiber optic endoscope, and they have just used to see the esophagus. It was first started using in the human by in 1822 by William Beaumont. And this is the original photograph where he is seeing the upper esophagus, cervical esophagus. At that time, it was a very crude technique. Now, there are many types of endoscope available, like fiber optic endoscope, video endoscope, capsule endoscope, then transanal micro endoscopic procedures, then the double balloon endoscope. Among all those endoscopes, the fiber endoscope was the first which was invented, and it works on the principle of total internal reflection. We know that the light cannot travel to the curve pathway, it need any reflector to change the direction of the light. But if any transmitting media is less than 5 micron in diameter, then light can travel even in the curve pathway due to the total internal reflection, because light will be reflected by the surface itself, and that is called as total internal reflection. These fiber optics has two row. The central column of the fiber optic is to take the image, and the peripheral fiber optics was to throw the light inside. It is very good, but it has few drawback. One of the drawback is that you cannot do the digital enhancement of the image. Whatever image you have is optical, there is no any electronic part inside. So you cannot adjust the shutter speed, you cannot adjust the fibroscope filter, you cannot adjust the aperture, you cannot do the white balancing, because it is a pure optical object, there is no electronic circuit inside. Another drawback is you cannot project the image on the monitor. So giving training is very difficult. If you have to train anyone, you need one extra attachment, and that will be for trainee. He will see only in the eyepiece. Third problem is there is no way to capture the data. You have to just write with your pen that esophagus normal, stomach normal, duodenal there are small ulcers, but you cannot say the texture of the ulcer, you cannot say about any of the micro neovascularization, or you cannot tell about the diameter. Whatever you will draw, whatever you will write, that patient has to believe it. Another drawback is that in due course of the time, once you will bend it, the fiber optic started breaking and it will make a black spots. What is advantage? Advantage is it is very handy. If you are a freelancer, you can carry it in your this briefcase and you can go from one place to another place. Another advantage is that this fiber optic endoscope is cheap. If you will buy in 1 lakh rupees, you can buy the upper GI endoscope. And if you have to work in the rural area where the patient cannot pay that much, it's a good alternative because it is cheaper. Third advantage, next advantage is maintenance is also not risky. It is easy to maintain because there is no any electronic part, there is no any that voltage will fluctuate and something will blow out. So that's why it is useful. But most of the people nowadays, they use video endoscope. Video endoscope is completely digitalized, it has chip on tip technology, so that the light fibers are only used to throw the light inside. But image is not taken by the fiber optics, image is taken by the CCD which is at the tip. So charge coupled device which you know in the laparoscope, it is in the camera head, inside the camera head. The same charge coupled device is here at the tip of the endoscope, so that it is digitally capturing the image. There is a processor, that processor can do the digital enhancement. If the light is come, you can decrease the shutter speed. If light is more, you can increase the shutter speed. Not only that, you have a lot of advantage of showing the different spectrum of the light inside, that is called as narrow band imaging. NBI. And if you will do the narrow band imaging, you can see the neovascularization. Cancer tissue, you can through the different spectrum of light. The benign tissue will not be get neovascularization in that spectrum of light. That is a great advantage. Another advantage is you can easily capture the video, entire procedure can be recorded because it is digital. So you can attach one pen drive and you can in the report you can give the real picture of the patient pathology. So patient satisfaction is also very good. Training, giving training is easy because once you are doing, every one of your resident is seeing on the monitor that how you maneuver. So due to this, nowadays video endoscopy is only used. There is no role of fiber endoscope unless until you have the financial constraint. Otherwise, video endoscopy is good to use because the image quality cannot be imagined in the fiber optic endoscope. Same image quality will not be there. Capsule endoscope, once it was invented, it was thought that it will be a very good dramatical effect it will give, and it is very interesting that this invention was done by two people at the same time. That was Paul Swan and Gabby Eden. Both had independently invented it in 1996. Independently means both came for the patent at the same time and both were at different place. And it was a miracle that how can a two person can invent the same thing differently, independently at the same time. But it was decided that okay, both of their invention was authentic, they were not copying each other because the way of doing research of both of them was different and their data was also different, their research methodology were also correct. So both were credited to invent the capsule endoscope. Capsule endoscope, once it came into the market, it has a lot of advantage that it has a lens. That lens will project the image to the CCD. This is charge coupled device, this is CCD. There are LED lights on the periphery, two battery and one antenna. So once it will drop inside the abdomen, it will give you a light, light will be switched on, and due to light the image will go to this lens. Lens will just focus the image to the CCD, CCD will capture, and with the antenna by the Bluetooth technology or wireless technology it can be sent outside also, or it can be memorized also. And once the patient will pass the capsule in the fetus, fecal matter, then you can try to get it and you can examine it. Capsule endoscopy is very good to identify the pathology if the patient cannot tolerate the conventional endoscopy, like patient is severe psychiatric problems and the patient has a severe cervical spondylitis or any other pathology. In those situations, you can give capsule endoscope. But it has a problem that a lot of 65% to 85% of the pathology, sometime a specific pathology is missed. Generalized pathology is not missed, but a specific pathology is missed. Do you know why? Because you are not distending the lumen in the capsule endoscopy. Lumen is collapsed. And once the lumen is collapsed, then there is no space for the light to throw out. Just like if there something touch your telescope, you cannot see. If fecal matter and blood is touching the telescope in laparoscopy, you cannot see. Another problem is it is a free fall. It is just like someone has given you the camera and he has kicked you out from a aeroplane. And now you are falling out in a parachute with a camera. Now at any moment of time, if you want to take image, you cannot stop because you are falling and you are taking an image. Now it is your luck. If the pathology is coming in your way, it will be captured. But at the time you are free fall of the capsule is there, pathology was behind, pathology was other side, it won't be captured. But when you are doing manually endoscopy and anywhere you have a doubt, you are stopping. You stop, you irrigate, you suck, you distend, you talk with your colleague that is it looking like a Crohn's disease? Yes sir, it is looking like some inflammation. Okay, you go more nearer, you increase the intensity of light, you will wash the mucosa and you will confirm your diagnosis. In capsule you cannot stop. So that's why a lot of pathology is missed. So it has only a specific indication, it is not for everyone. And capsule retention occur in 1.4% of the cases. Where capsule doesn't come out, then endoscopic or sometimes surgical intervention is required. Double balloon endoscopy, this is very good for seeing the terminal ileum, because in conventional endoscope we can go only up to the second part of duodenum. After second part of duodenum there is acute bend. So, in acute bend if you will try to push the endoscope, there will be looping effect. Looping effect means, suppose I am bending like that and then I am pushing, then loop will be pushed, it will not go ahead and there will be lot of difficulty, you cannot go. So, in those situation double balloon endoscope was invented, and it was Yamamoto who has invented in year 2000. What is the concept of this double balloon endoscope? The concept is, it was the idea taken by earthworm. If you see the earthworm, how they move, they will stretch the upper body first and they will stick with the soil, and then they will pull the lower body, and again they will elongate the upper body, they will fix it and then they will pull the lower body. So, they are sticking with the soil or any object over which they move. Same way it has two balloons and there is a tube within tube. First you have to push the inner tube, and then inner tube will be inflated, which will hold the lumen of the small bubble, and then the outer tube will pull up, and that way it can keep on going to up to the terminal ileum. Sometime there is a problem, sometime this balloon can rupture and there may be retention, there may be some injury, but in many situations nowadays good double balloon endoscopes are available, and these are the Fuji is also one of the good company, Olympus is one of the very good company. They are making the sophisticated double balloon endoscope that can allow the visualization of the entire small bubble up to the terminal ileum, up to the terminal ileum. Otherwise, examining the entire ileum with the conventional endoscope is impossible. And here it allows the sampling or biopsying of the small bubble, or sometime resection of the small polyp, or sometime to remove the stricture on the Billroth 2 type of intratomy if you have done, or any pathological stricture is there, then you can do the balloon dilatation. And this way it is very useful, but it has to be carefully used, it is not for everyone. Now come the ERCP. ERCP is also one of the very innovative procedure which has revolutionized the way how the CVD pathology was dealt before, because for CVD stone and all it has become nowadays the gold standard, because of the quality of life is much better and it is minimally invasive procedure. It is side viewing endoscope, we will see you, show you in the lab. This is a side viewing endoscope which is seeing on the side and light is also on the side, so that you can put a guide wire and then you under fluoroscopy, under C arm fluoroscopy, you can get an entire image of the biliary tree, and then you can put a dormia basket and you can take all the stone out. If there is any malignancy or any other pathology, you can put a stent, different type of stent, metal stents are there, the plastic stents are there, that you can be given. And sometime you can go with the micro ERCP, which has the ERCP in one endoscope is going through the ERCP, so that this small micro endoscope can enter into the CVD, and through that the channel directly you can take a biopsy from the CVD. In the conventional ERCP, you are just seeing indirect image by fluoroscopy, but here there is a tube within tube, and through which here is also CCD that can directly take the image from the CVD. And there is a pneumatic or ultrasonic lithotripter which can directly break the stone if the stone is so bad and if it is so much incarcerated that even the guide wire cannot pass ahead and you cannot put a dormia basket to catch the stone, then you can do the lithotripter and directly you can break by seeing the stone. So, this type of technology has been revolutionized the way how the CVD pathology was dealt before. Before performing endoendoscopy, nurse should explain what is going to happen and answer all the questions to the patient. Then nurse should record the BP plus respiration, everything, all the vital parameters should be recorded, and all the comorbidities should be must carefully taken. If the patient has any comorbidity, severe comorbidity, then it should must be noted, and after that you will start the procedure. Endoscopy can be performed without sedation, but sedation is good, because if you will give IV medazolam or pentazocine, then the patient will little bit be sedated, although you should give the short acting diazepam so that there will be very less or minimum respiratory depression. You should not give the simple diazepam, midazolam is better, and IV propofol is given to the patient who is not cooperative or the patient who is in the ICU or patient who is intubated, and if you have to give then IV propofol you can use because it is a short term general anesthesia, and that can be avoided using antispasmodic during intubation. Otherwise, there is a possibility that you will enter into the airway. But if you have to give antispasmodic, then once you have entered, then you can give so that a sphincter of OD will relax and sometime the flow of bile can be easily seen. If you are doing the upper GI endoscopy, then only 4 to 6 hour patient should be empty stomach. But if you are doing lower GI, then you should prepare the colon, and 24 hour clean fluid liquid can be given, clear liquid can be given, that is transparent liquid, or peglec powder, that is polyethylene glycol. Peglec powder with the electrolyte solution should be given 140 milligram with the 2 liter of the fluid overnight. You have to perform the procedure tomorrow, then at night the patient should take 140 gram of the peglec powder with the 2 liter of the liquid. Any liquid can be taken, like glucose means solution, or you can have the apple juice or cold drink, and the patient can drink within 2-3 hour, and she will get some or he will get some diarrhea, bowel will be prepared. In case of sometime emergency like colonic obstruction or the patient has acute GI bleeding, you do not have time to prepare the bowel. In that situation, in the emergency you have to do. Now, anesthesia, you can have a spray, xylocaine or lignocaine spray, which you have to inject, and then that way you can perform, and that will give you the advantage that the once the patient will swallow, the patient will not have any of the this irritation, and patient can swallow smoothly, and it will become slippery also. So, xylocaine, viscous or a spray or jelly can be swallowed, and after that you will perform the procedure. So, indications, I will not go in the deep of the indication. There are hundreds of indications which you can, simple from the uncomplicated dyspepsia up to check the healing and progress of the polyp or growth or tumor or ulcer. Means almost any case, if you have a doubt about the upper GI, you can do the endoscopy. Nowadays, upper GI endoscopy becomes like a routine procedure. Even if the patient has a peptic ulcer, even the patient has a gastric lympho, even the patient has the indigestion, in those situations also you can do the upper GI endoscopy. So, there is a huge list of the indication which you can do. Now, we will see some of the slides, some of the videos that how it looks like. Once you will enter into the stomach, this is the rugis which you will see, and then you will go to the antrum. In the antrum, longitudinal folds are not present. That way antrum is mucosal, longitudinal folds are not present. In the stomach, I will show you again here, these are the folds which is present. Can you see this here? And as soon as these folds become absent, that means it is antrum now. This is the antrum, and then you will go, this is the stomach greater curvature and body, and this is antrum, and now you will enter into the pylorus. After that you can go ahead up to the second part of duodenum. Most of the time diagnosis is done at the time of removing the endoscope. During going it, our main aim is to enter safely, and after that if there is an ulcer, you can identify the ulcer, you can see if there is any other candidiasis or other problem or carcinoma, and then you can see, you can, if you want you can take a biopsy. There are some time you will get a, this is, you can see the ampulla, you can see the ampullary carcinoma. Ampulla will be visualized, and here you can see the ampullary carcinoma, and again biopsy can be taken. If there are coins which is left inside, or foreign body, or denture, or the fish bone, and if you have to take, then you can take it out. So, there are different patients comes to you with the different things swallowed. In those situations, you have to take, like these are the coins there, you can remove it. Although in many situations removal is not necessary, because once it has gone out of the pylorus, then it is hardly going to stuck anywhere. Hiatus hernia. Hiatus hernia, if you have to identify, then after going inside, you have to do J maneuver. What is J maneuver? That entire endoscope turn the J, and then you will just little bit rotate the hand so that you can see the fundus and you can find out the black hole, and you have to distend the stomach little bit, and that way J maneuver can show you the. So this is the black hole which is seen. Sometime when you will make it up, you can see the endoscope itself. This is the gastroesophageal junction, and endoscope is seen itself, because once you will do J maneuver, this endoscope will be visible. So this is the entry of the endoscope, and then once you will rotate, you can see the fundus and you can identify the hiatus. So this way, hiatus hernia for these cases, endoscopy is the gold standard for the diagnosis, and even the size and even the other things can be identified. It has been performed in many cases of the foreign body retrieval, just like this is a fish bone. During introduction of the endoscope inside the esophagus, nothing was seen. This is the gastroesophageal junction here, and now it is entered into the stomach. Once you will enter into the stomach, here this is the junction, and then it was a J maneuver. Nothing was visualized, everything was fine, and this is the J maneuver. Here this is the endoscope itself is showing, this is the gastroesophageal junction through which it has came. Everything is fine, but at a time of withdrawal, a small fish bone was seen hidden into the mucosa, and it has drawn the attention, and here was the fish bone. Now you can catch it by a grasper, and then you can pull it. Take care that there should not be transverse arrest, and you should catch it on the one side so that it becomes longitudinal. Otherwise, it is, if you are holding in the middle, there may be little transverse arrest. So this is the way how you can hold it, and slowly it can be pulled out. So this type of foreign body can be easily taken by the endoscope with the just holding by the grasper and slowly pulling everything out. Just like in laparoscope, you are holding a neck of a gallbladder and pulling everything out. Same way you can retrieve it. So foreign body retrieval is one of the very important indication, which in day to day life the small child also can come, and you have to remove it. Now it is, this is a small fish bone which is out. Then you can do, in many situations you can do the broken T-tube removal. This patient has a small T-tube which was introduced laparoscopically. Now at the time of retrieval it has broken, and now this is the ERCP, and this is the guide wire going in the fluoroscopy, and this is the T-tube. At this place it was broken, and this is a dormia basket which you will try to push it in and entangle the T-tube and take it out. And this is the dye, this is fluoroscopy which is showing you. This is a sphinctectomy. A sphinctectomy is generally done at 11 o'clock position. A sphinctectomy is always required whenever you are doing ERCP. Most of the time, do you know why? So that a sphincter of Oddi pressure will decrease and you can enter inside, and it can give you free flow of the bile. So that this is a sphinctectomy is done. After that, it is a guide wire which will be introduced and followed by dormia basket. Here the dormia basket is trying to entangle this T-tube, and it is failed many a time. One time it is going, it is failed. Second time failed. Third time it was caught. So this is the dormia basket which is going and trying to entangle it anywhere. This is a blind procedure, so you have to do several trials, and one trial you will be successful. Again this is the dormia basket which is trying to go and trying to just entangle it anyhow. So this is second attempt, and it is again failed. Now the third attempt it was caught, and the T-tube is out. So for the same reason you have to do surgery, and by ERCP you can take it minimally invasive without any problem. Patient can go back home just within 2 hours. Here was the place from where it was broken. At this point, at a time here this was broken. So these type of procedures are very useful to do ERCP. This is endoscopic pseudocyst drainage. This patient has a pseudopancreatic cyst, and in those situations the drainage can be done by endoscopy. You can first go inside and you can put a small needle, you can inject the vasopressin so that there will be minimum bleeding, and then you can inject it dye inside the pseudocyst, and you can put a guide wire. So these are therapeutic as well as have a diagnostic advantage also. So this is injecting, and then here it enters. And now this is the guide wire into the cyst, The entire cyst, here is the guide wire, and it is showing the boundary of the cyst. Now you can inject, you can put one balloon dilator so that the opening can be stretched out, opening can be dilated. So this is a dilator which is going, and it will enlarge the opening by this plastic balloon. You have to inflate and it will enlarge the opening, and then you will see it is dilating the balloon and enlarging the opening, so that all the content of the cyst will drain into the stomach, and after that you can put a stent so that drainage will keep on going into the stomach. So this type of endoscopic pseudocyst drainage by endoscopy has a lot of advantage, and this is a stent over the guide wire which is pushed in, and then you can take it out. So not only diagnostic, a lot of therapeutic value is also there in endoscopy, but naturally in the beginning we should start with the diagnostic endoscopy, and later you can do the therapeutic. So this is the stent falling into the stomach. Then narrow band imaging. Narrow band imaging, what is this narrow band imaging? It is for malignancy. Here 440 to 460 nanometer, that is blue light, is thrown over the malignant tissue. And do you know the type of equation here is that peak light absorption of hemoglobin occur at this wavelength, and blood vessel will appear very dark. So you can see this is the blood vessels are looking very dark, and this is neovascularization, and you can identify the even the patient who may develop the malignancy later, that can also be identified by the narrow band imaging technique. And in those situations you can take a biopsy also from a correct place, which can give you the better outcome, otherwise you will take a biopsy from the wrong place. So this is the different type of wavelength, ambient light of wavelength, that is blue and the green, and here this is the neovascularization, and then you can go there and you can take the biopsy, and this is the histopathology, and you can see the different type of malignancy or carcinoma in situ can be identified, and it has a great value. So this type of new technology, these are the NBI imaging, which will not be seen by the fiber optic endoscope, because fiber optic endoscope does not have any digital control over the different spectrum of the light. But with the video endoscope you can identify, and these of pathology can be much earlier seen, before it occurs you can identify it. Now GERD is very good to be identified by the endoscopy, and it has a Los Angeles classification. Los Angeles classification grade A is when there is only one or more mucosal break, but not more than 5 millimeter, and it has not been extended up to the top of the two mucosal fold. So this is called as grade A. So grade A Los Angeles classification, you can see these are the mucosal break, these are the ulcers, but they are not more than 5 millimeter, and one or two you can see these are the mucosal break, but they are not extending up to the top of the two mucosal fold. So this is grade A, this is very good, it can be healed by the medical treatment also. It may not be necessary for those patients to go for the fundoplication or any surgery, and this can be identified very easily. So there are four grade. Now LA grade B is one or two mucosal break, it is more than 5 millimeter, and it does not extend at the top of the two mucosal fold. So in those situations the size is little big, but still it has not extended up to the top of the two mucosal fold. So in those situations, here this is the ulcer, and there are few more, here is one ulcer, these are the healthy mucosa. So in those cases the patient has to be strictly change the dietary habit, and the aggressive treatment is required. Now LA grade B, C or D sometime in those patients, if the they are refractory to the medical management or it has intolerance to the proton pump inhibitor, in those situations fundoplication is also required. In grade C it is going up to the top, but less than 75% of the circumference is affected, less than 75% of the circumference is affected, and of course it is bigger than 5 millimeter. So this is grade C LA classification. In those situation, you can see it is going up to the top of the mucosal fold, but these are the healthy mucosa. This is the ulcer, and these are healthy. So altogether, on less than 75% of the mucosa is ulcerated, remaining is completely healthy. So that is grade C, and in grade D, the more than 75% is affected by the ulcer. Those patients are very difficult to clean teeth by the medical management, and in those situations you have to take the other strategy. So this is one or more mucosal break which involve at least 75% or more of the mucosal folds, and here in this patient we can see there are so much ulceration that these are only the healthy mucosa. This all is ulcerated, these all are mucosal break, and it is extending to on the top of the two mucosal fold. So in those situation, LA classification is very useful, and all over world it is accepted now as one of the endoscopy. Once you do and you have the GERD, you have to write the LA classification A, B, C, D in your report. Sometimes poem is also a very good technique, that is called as peroral endoscopic myotomy. We know that we are doing the laparoscopic myotomy. Laparoscopic myotomy, just like fundoplication, you will mobilize oesophagus and then you have to split the muscles of the oesophagus at least 5 centimeter, 3 centimeter longitudinal, 2 centimeter circular muscle fiber, that will relieve. But why to go by laparoscope? You can go endoscopically. How? You incise the mucosa. As we know that in the oesophagus there is no serosa. So if you incise the mucosa and you will enter in the submucosa plane, then automatically you are in the muscle, and then with a small microplasma kinetic energy you can cut the muscle also. That is called as POEM. So it is very good for oesophageal achalasia, and it is an endoscopic procedure. So first you have to inject the methylene blue together with the vasopressin, so that it will give you a dye, and methylene blue has advantage that suppose anyhow it is getting ruptured, then it will draw your attention, and it is injected now, and then you will cut it longitudinally with the monopolar current. So this is the mucosa which is cut, and after that endoscope itself with one of the control electronic, you will enter into the submucous plane, and then you can just cut the muscles. So this is a advanced technique which is done by good endoscopic physicians, and that has an advantage that it is a day care procedure. You do not have to go for any laparoscopy, any general anesthesia, you do not have to go for aggressive operative procedure, and now it is slowly injecting, and it will distend the layers, and then you can cut the muscles, and once the circular muscle fibers comes, that also can be easily seen. So basically the same muscle which you were cutting by laparoscopy from outside, it is cut from inside endoscopically, and you have to perforate the mucosa to enter into the muscle, and at the end when you will withdraw the endoscope, you can clip the mucosa with the endoscopy clipper and keep the patient nearly couple of days, and automatically this mucosa will repair, and after that patient can have the normal. So this is now going slowly, and this is the plane which will cut the circular muscle fibers also. So I will take little forward fast. No, you will not perforate the esophagus. You will be in. Yes, still remain, and then you will enter slowly. Sorry. So this way, and at the end I wanted to show you. At the end, once you have performed the procedure, then you come out and then you have to clip. So this is very interesting, and in those situation here this is a clip which is applied on the bridge of the mucosa, so that it will repair its own. So these POEM procedures is slowly becoming popular in India also. Many of the physician gastroenterologists, they have started doing this procedure, and now I see here the stricture is relieved, and you can see that there is no much achalasia, and that is fine. So result is also there. You can do J manoeuvre also, and this is the gastroesophageal junction. That is also very fine. Now it is not that much narrow, so this is a good procedure. Again, the colonoscopy. Colonoscopy, you have the a lot of advantage in the patient, elderly patient. It should be performed routinely. If there is even the altered bowel habit, then also this procedure should be performed. This is a normal villi, how it look like, and then you will enter into the colon, and after that you will see the different appendiceal orifice. Once you will enter into the cecum, and you can see the ileocecal valve and junction also. So here it is withdrawing the endoscope, and this is appendiceal orifice, and these are lymphoid aggregates. As you know, that colonoscopy is not recommended in the acute appendicitis, but sometime even you can see the round worm going into the appendix in the rural areas. So those type of pathology is very interesting. These are lymphoid aggregates, which can show you some of the idea about the previous episodes of the appendicitis also. You can identify each and every structure, and you can give your time while withdrawing it out, and even the ileocecal valves can be also easily identified. You have the different type of folds here. This is the ileocecal valve. There are different type of folds, that is called as hostra or plica semilunaris. So these folds have to be identified, and sometime diverticulosis is hidden within these folds. That also has to be taken care of. So during withdrawal, you have to give the time. This is hostra, that is a depression, and this is the plica semilunaris, that is the elevation of the ring. And in those situations, these are the typical appearance for the colon while you are coming out. So these are semilunar folds, and in between there should not be any fecal matter. That's why in the colonoscopy, bowel preparation is very important, and a good bowel preparation can give you the better view. Otherwise, it will be completely impacted by the fecal matter, and you cannot identify. Now again, you will come back slowly, and suppose anywhere you have some depression like diverticulosis and all, you have to stop, little bit irrigate the saline, little bit suck and clean the fecal matter here, and then identify it. Like here, it is withdrawing slowly, and these are little fecal matter which is trying to deviate, and once it is taken out, once it is removed, then you can see if there is any diverticulosis. Like here, this is diverticulosis, and that can be missed in many of the other way of doing endoscopy. So a good endoscopist, sometime in the severe Crohn's disease, in the pediatric cases, laparoscopic assisted colonoscopy is performed, so that you can see the diverticulosis, and you can see the big diverticulum, and you can stop the endoscope entering into the wrong diverticulum, and you can guide the laparoscope to move the endoscope correctly. So this type of advanced technology is available now for the colonoscopy. Now sometime you have to see the parasite also accidentally. Like here it is going, and there was a small parasite which was hooking into the mucosa, and it was drawing the blood of the patient. Although if you will go to the rural areas of the Indian continent, that in many of the small child, you have a lot of round worms, the bunch of the round worms can be seen. This type of parasites can be visualized by occasionally in the colonoscopy, and in the tropical countries, it is very often finding, very common, and that you can see. Again, you can see a lot of irrigation is performed, but in spite of that, that parasite is not going out, which is completely holding the mucosa of the patient. In those situations, sometime you can catch it by, and you can burn it, you can destroy it. Otherwise, you can take it out and you can examine, you can send for histopathology, you can find out the way the pathology, these parasites are there, and then exact medicine can be started. Sometime you have the ulcerative colitis. In this, once you will enter back, you can see easily the different ulcers, and then you can identify it. Again, biopsy can be taken, and you can send the patient with the histopathology, and you can appropriate medicine can be started. For ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, these are completely dependent upon the colonoscopic finding, and here you can see these are the ulcerations, and again histopathology is required. Sometimes the patient has a polypectomy, like this is a colon and there is a polyp. This polyp has a multiple lobule, so you have to do the piecemeal resection, just like loop electrode, just like the gynecologist how they use the resector scope of hysteroscopy. Same way in the endoscope you have the loop electrode, and then first you have to inject the vasopressin, just like the same 5 international unit of vasopressin will be diluted with the 20 ml saline, and then you will inject it at the base of these polyps so that it will create transient ischemia, and once the ischemia is created, after that you can apply it there. So this way you have the advantage that the patient will have minimum bleeding. This is the vasopressin which is injected, so that transient, just like how in the myomectomy we inject the vasopressin, same way here, but here only few ml is required, and then monopolar loop electrode is there. You have a roller ball also, or the monopolar coagulation current also. So if there is bleeding, you can apply the ball and you can do the fulguration. Fulguration is coagulation current from some distance. So fulguration is also called as a spray mode, so that it will stop the bleeding. Now this is loop, and these polyps will be entangled into the loop, just like the sneer, how the ENT surgeon, they take the nasal polyps, same way you can entangle it, and with the current you can cut it, so that there will be minimum bleeding, and piecemeal way polyps can be taken out. If you have a doubt about the malignancy, then you can cut a small person, and then just you can bring it out for the histopathology. But if you are sure that it is benign, then you can do the entire polypectomy, so that the one of the cause of the lower GI bleeding is the polyp, as you know. In those situation, it can be completely cured. One of the problem is that there may be perforation of the colon. So you must be very good in knowing the principle of electrosurgery, that how much watt should be used, what is cutting, what is coagulation, what is blend, what is direct coupling, what is capacitive coupling, what is insulation failure, because all these principles are applied wherever you are using electrosurgery. If you are using in endoscopy or if you are using in laparoscopy, these principles of electrosurgery already you know, and then you can use it. So these are the small piecemeal, and these are the cut piece which you can leave into the colon, which will come out with the fecal matter. This is again cut out, and now the remaining small portion will be removed. This is just a small portion is kept, and that is also cut. And now if the base is bleeding, you can do the fulguration, like here. If it is bleeding, you can touch it and you can change the electrosurgical unit to the fulguration mode, and you can touch and stop the those bleedings. So in many situations, there may be one small stalk which may be bleeding and fulguration is required, that will be very useful. Sometimes you can do the carcinoma of the colon, and in those situations cauliflower like growth is there, and in those situations you can just take a biopsy and come out. This is the carcinoma of the colon. For that colonoscopy is very important. Even if you are doing laparoscopy, in laparoscopy we don't have tactile feedback, so we cannot decide during surgery that how much colon has to be removed. So complete colonoscopy and tattooing of the tumor is required, so that once you go by laparoscopy, you can decide that how much you have to resect. Because in open surgery you can palpate the tumor, and 10 centimeter distal, proximal, and 5 centimeter distal you can decide then and there. But in laparoscopy, colonoscopy is very important to give you. Then the ERCP for stone removal. This is a separate entity. Here this is the sphincter of Oddi, and here it is the instrument which is introduced, and after that you will do the, you will put the sphincterectomy, and you will do the sphincterectomy. And this is the monopolar current which will cut at 11 o'clock position, and it will do the sphincterectomy. After that you can introduce the dormia basket and you can remove the stone out. So this is cutting now, and slowly when you are cutting, you must be very careful. You will be surprised that sometime in the ERCP the mortality rate is 0.5%. So it is not as innocent as once upon a time it was thought, because there is a lot of complications. In the beginning, when the people they start doing ERCP, they go 5 times into the pancreatic duct and then 1 time into the CBD, and while going repeatedly to the pancreatic duct, you can induce the pancreatitis, you can induce the cholangitis, and sometimes there may be a severe perforation and death. So it has to be recommended that every physician or surgeon who is planning to do ERCP, they should have first at least 200 cases of the upper GI endoscopy done. After that, you think about ERCP, so that your reflex of the angulation wheel is perfect and you know how to maintain the orientation. So, now this is the guide wire which is pulling the stone, and all the stone can be taken out. So, now these stones are coming out with the guide wire. So, this is a very good procedure and it has a lot of advantage. Now, you have the some other invasive like TEM. TEM is one of the very good procedure which was invented by Professor Gerhard Busch, that is called as transanal endoscopic microsurgery. This is one of the beautiful endoscopic procedure which is for the rectal tumors, and if there is any rectal pathology you can use. Benign indications of TEM are rectal polyp, carcinoid tumor, retrorectal abscesses, anastomic stricture, extra sphincteric fistula and the pelvic abscesses. Malignant indications are either extreme beginning or extreme end, like T1, T2 cancer you can do, but there should not be nodal metastasis, node should not be involved, or in the extreme end, it means terminally ill patient in which there is no any cure is possible. In those situations, you can palliative treatment just to do the channeling, TEM can be performed. It is used for full colonoscopy should be performed, rigid proctoscopy should be performed, endorectal ultrasound must be done, and you should must confirm the stage of the tumor, that should be T0, T1, and you should must take care that T1, T2 with the nodal metastasis should not be performed the surgery. When you are putting the patient on the table for doing the TEM, you have to make it sure that pathology should come at 6 o'clock position. So, if the pathology is already 6 o'clock position, you will keep the patient supine, so that pathology will come at 6. If the pathology is night 9 o'clock position, then you will keep the patient right lateral, and if the patient is pathology is at 12 o'clock position, then you will keep the patient prone, and after that you will start doing the procedure. This is the way how the TEM procedure is performed, and even up to the terminal part of the rectum and above the rectosigmoid junction, you can take the pathology out. Benign indications are all the benign indications are there, and in malignant, extreme beginning and extreme end. Equipments that operative instruments are made by two company, one is the Wolf, another is Starge, which is making these instruments. You have the 40mm proctoscope with the blunt obturator, which you need to use it, and the instruments are same like laparoscopy, and some articulating instruments are used like articulating hook or sometime articulating grasper is used in the TEM. This procedure is useful with the stereoscope, that is one stereoscope which you can introduce, and after that you can see the binocular vision, and then you can perform the TEM. TEM has a beautiful indication because stereoscope will give you the 3D vision, whereas a simple if you will see on the monitor, it will give you 2D vision, and then you have to insufflate also the rectum, and the 40mm proctoscope has to be introduced first, and after that you can start doing surgery. Even the tumor, you can with the healthy tumor margin, you can remove it out. So, first you will see how to position the patient. Patient is in the lithotomy position, nicely draped, nicely clean, and after that you have to give the full muscle relaxant. Full muscle relaxant, so that entire four finger you can introduce into the anus. This is the stand to fix the proctoscope, that stand is fixed with the OT table, and then you can see that there is a nice sphincter relaxation, and there is a lot of gelocaine jelly and all should be given, and then you will introduce the 40mm proctoscope. Initially this proctoscope will go at 12 o'clock position, and as soon as the obturator is introduced, after that you will deviate little bit towards the left, so that it can go into the rectum nicely, and then this stand you can fix, and then you can take the obturator out, and this proctoscope will be alone left inside, and then you have to use an adapter. Now this obturator of the proctoscope will be taken out. Now you can attach the insufflator and the light cable in the same instrument, so that it will be nicely fixed, so that you can have now the channel for introducing the instrument, surgical instrument, and then you can attach, this is the insufflator tubing CO2, and this is the light cable which is attached, and after that you can start performing the procedure. The first step of the start performing the procedure is tattooing of the tumor, so that if there is a tumor, you should do tattooing all around healthy margin, so that once you will start doing the surgery, you will not misinterpretate the anatomy. You will remember the place where you have to cut the anatomy, and this is called as misinterpretation of the anatomy, and otherwise it will happen. So tattooing is very important, so that it will give you a landmark, so that you can remove the tumor with the healthy normal margins. So this is this will help you during the resection. So tattooing of the tumor will be performed all around. You have to use very less wattage of the current, so that only mucosa should burn and you will not deviate it. Now this is complete. After that, tumor resection will start, and tumor resection again you have to take the articulating instrument, and so that your manipulation angle will be minimum 30 degree, because your azimuth angle is 0 degree. Your telescope and the instrument is parallel. That means angle between the telescope and instrument is called as azimuth angle, that is 0 degree. So in those situation, to take the manipulation angle, the instrument, if it is bent, then it will give you 30 degree manipulation angle, and then you will be able to resect the tumor. During tumor resection, you have to take care that only mucosa, submucosa should be cut, and it should not be perforated. Perforation, if it occurs, sometime laparoscopic assisted repair is required. If it perforates, then you may have to put a trocar from above, and then you need to suture laparoscopically. Some of the people like Professor Gerhard Busch, he was able to repair it endoscopically itself, but it is not possible with everyone. And this is the tumor which is resected. With a plasma kinetic energy you will use, so that even the 5 watt of current can give you the good cutting effect because of higher frequency. So hardly you can see any smoke, but still it is a good cutting effect, and then you can resect the tumor. The tattooing of the tumor, these are the tattooing. Tattooing of the tumor is giving you the exact landmark, so that you will not miss any of the cancer. Especially the patient who has a carcinoma in situ and who has accidentally diagnosed cancer, the TEM is a curative procedure which can prevent the patient going to the low anterior resection or patient unnecessarily going to the laparotomy. So if it is early required, TEM is 100% curative. But only problem in the country like India is that our patient doesn't turn up that much earlier, and if already nodal metastasis is done, then there is no advantage. So the patient selection is the paramount for the success of this type of surgery, because if the patient selection is good, patient will have a lot of advantage and early diagnosis. So this is the entire tumor which is resected. Now one of the challenges is how to do the suturing, because suturing you don't have a good manipulation angle to make a C and reverse C and tie a knot. So for that, to prevent, do the suturing, the bead is used, that is a bead technique. What is that? The titanium beads are there, and when you are taking the bite, you can clip the suture itself by the bead, so that the suture will act as a knot, and then your continuous knot can be taken without tying a knot. So this is a polygalactane, and it is taking a continuous suturing. Polygalactane has an advantage that within few months it will slowly set out and it will absorb, and it is continuous suturing, and this is a bead, and these beads are holding the knot. So it is just like a titanium clip, but it is more voluminous, so that it will not allow the suture to go back. So it is acting as a knot. This you are doing already in hernia surgery. Sometime when you close the peritoneum after putting the mesh and you cannot do Aberdeen termination, then you are clipping the suture itself with the titanium, so that suture should not go back. Same way here you can do, and you can close the mucosa also, submucosa also. So these type of procedures has a great advantage to the patient, and unnecessarily they don't have to go for the invasive procedure. Again, this is a second layer. Sometime if it is ruptured or if it is a small perforation, endoscopically also it can be sealed, and then one varus needle will be introduced to the Palmer's point to remove the trapped gas, because once it is perforated, gas may leak into the abdomen. That's why before starting this procedure, neomycin, cetrorhizal, and antihelminthic should be given 1 week before the surgery. Like bowel preparation should be started 8 days before the surgery, so that all the bowel flora will get eradicated and all the bacterial flora of the colon should be removed, so that even if it is little leak, there will be no any bacterial peritonitis. So good bowel preparation is required before performing this procedure. Now this is the termination, and this is a bead which is applied for the termination, and the surgery is performed. So these type of endoscopic procedures are slowly replacing many of the aggressive procedures which is done by surgeons. Now conclusion of the term is that it is technically demanding procedure which utilizes highly specialized instrumentation and advanced endoscopic technique can spare selected patient from laparotomy or anterior resection, but adequate training is imperative and patient selection is the paramount to perform this. Now risk of endoscopy. If you are doing endoscopy, allergic reaction of the contrast, if you have to use any contrast, must be checked before, because many a time during the sedation, if the contrast allergy is there, then there may be respiratory arrest. Puncture organ is also one of the risk. That's you should do the electrosurgery very carefully, otherwise you can perforate. Then third risk is over sedation. Ideally one anesthetist should be available whenever you do endoscopy, but if you could do cost strain in the small setup, generally we don't call the endoscopy. But if the anesthetist is not there for endoscopy, you should yourself should must have the laryngoscope, the good mouth airway and the oxygen and the parameters and emergency medicines like adrenaline and all should be there, so that in any emergency you can immediately resuscitate the patient. Another risk is infection. In high volume hospital where they have to perform 20 endoscopes in one day, sometimes they don't have sufficient time to put the patient endoscope in the sidex, and without properly giving the contact time with the sidex, immediately they take it out and do in the other patient. So that is also not a good practice. That's why in the USA, in the big hospital like Cleveland Clinic and all, they are using disposable endoscopes, where after every endoscope they throw the endoscope out and then they use the another. It is cheaper, not exactly same, but it is completely disposable. So this type of technology will prevent the patient infected in the HIV or hepatitis B. Now technical aspect is also very important. Before starting any endoscopy, the scope, endoscope, air, water, suction, angulation, wheel, leak of the endoscope must be checked. Light source, processor, suction machine, all accessories should be checked. Check for indication of the procedure. Consent must be taken from the patient. Do you know, and sometimes the patient has comorbidity like severe cervical spondylitis, severe hypertension, severe ketoacidosis, diabetes or tuberculosis, COPD, cardiac disease, then consent for high risk also should be taken, because you never know, patient can get the cardiac arrest during the procedure itself. And you should must explain the patient before bringing to the OT that what is going to happen to him, how you will put an endoscope, how patient should swallow. Otherwise if patient doesn't know anything, once you start doing, he will bite your endoscope, and once he will bite your endoscope, your 5 lakh rupees is gone, because tip of the endoscope CCD, if he will bite then it is gone. So that's why we keep one assistant behind to hold it, the head, and nasal oxygen should also be continuously given. So these technical aspects you will learn during these 4-day course, and you will understand how to do it. So thank you very much. This is me in the Imperial College London. This is Professor Gerhard Busch, who was one of my professors during my training. So thank you very much.